everybody, to the WCLM, also known as the Women of Color and Leadership Movement Community Podcast, in partnership with Media Island International. And we are doing another interview in our series of the Afro Hawaiian Experience. And this has been really wonderful. I mean, as I've shared with some of y'all before, I was born in New York, but raised in Hawaii. And so that was definitely an influence in my life. And to be able to reconnect with you know, some of the women of color that I've you know, grew up with from there, and have them share their stories, is really amazing. So this is our second interview coming up. And for, you know, for our listeners, you know, we're gonna be uploading this on YouTube and on our website pretty soon. So if you've been checking out some of our previous interviews, we got them all loaded up there. But without further ado, let me introduce our guest. We have a Gwendolyn Bailey. How are you doing, Gwendolyn?
Hey, Shauna, I'm doing good, and you?
I'm doing so good today, girl. We had some unexpected sun happen to come in here in Washington State today, so that's a big deal. So I'm doing good. So, I mean, you know, so let's get right on into it. Like, so tell us about yourself, where you were born and raised, and you know, about your life on the island, what island you lived on, and that kind of thing. Yeah, start from the roots and work our way up.
Okay. All right, so my name is Gwendolyn Ku'ule Bailey. I am born and raised on the island of Oahu, Honolulu, Hawaii. You know, I grew up in an area that is known in Hawaii to be the projects, at Kuhio Park Terrace, KPT. And to be honest with you, I've lived there all my life. I recently, last year, moved out here to Dallas, Texas. So I've been living on Oahu all my life. I am a certified substance abuse counselor for the past 23 years. Recently, just last year, as I moved from Hawaii to Texas, I shifted careers, and I am now a field underwriter / insurance broker. So as you can see, I have a passion for helping people.
All right. I can see we have other conversations to have on the side too. Insurance broker, you said, right? All right. That's good. Good for people to know. Now, is it a private business, or are you with a company or whatnot?
I'm with a company.
Okay. All right. Well, make sure, you know, toward the end when we close out, if you any information you want to share about that, please feel free. So tell us about your some of your, because we was talking, you know, offline a little bit, and we was talking about some of our experiences. And although it's, you know, it was a wonderful thing, you know, to be raised on in such a beautiful place. Oh, my goodness. I mean, yes. I stopped myself feeling like, oh, no, God made this. God lives here. I'm God, Goddess. They're here, right here, you know. But, you know, as with anything, there's also challenges, too. There's also, you know, challenges. I know from my own personal experience coming from New York. My mother actually intentionally moved to Hawaii thinking that we was going to be around other Black folks. She did the research and the research on how the original Hawaiians looked, and they looked much like us. So we thought we was going, you know, around our folks. So it was really kind of surprising and a lot disappointing to come and find the children, who a lot of them looked just like me, was still calling me the N-word, nigga, left and right, Black Dog, and Me'uli, a whole bunch of other names, Popolo, you know, and these are names that, you know, I heard my first 3 years living on Maui in Lahaina. And then when I came, you know, to Oahu to live and, you know, go to school, same thing. It's just that I saw some more African-Americans. And so that was an interesting perspective. Now for you, though, you were in that one particular area. And so tell us about some of your, you know, experiences. I mean, who brought you to this journey? Because you said you're doing substance abuse, certified substance abuse, and then now into insurance. And both of those are like, hey, safety net, you know, type career. So tell us about your journey.
All right. So first off, let me be more specific about my ethnicity as part of my background. So I have my dad's African-American Indian, and then my mom, throughout my whole life, I was told that she's Hawaiian, Chinese, Filipino. Later on to find out that there were other nationalities in, you know, in there, and that we have a lot more Hawaiian than we thought we did. You know, but growing up, that's all I said, Hawaiian, Chinese, Filipino, Black. You know, and back then we called African-American Black. Now, Dad, we were raised, I'm the baby of six. I have my own father, and he was in my life till I was about eight and got up and left. That was that. So mom pretty much raised all six children on her own, you know, the best that she could. And if you ask me, she did that, girl. Of course, coming into or living in Hawaii, being raised by a Hawaiian Chinese Filipino mother, right? Our culture was totally different from what my dad was trying to do in the household. Now, the challenges that I suffered growing up, as early as I can remember, is being African American and not being accepted, you know, being teased a lot, you know, Black N, Meuli, Olopops, you know, just all these.
What's Olopops? Is that doodle?
So Olo, like how you say Popolo, like Popolo was natural to us. You know, for us, Popolo in Hawaiian just means of color, Popolo. You know what I mean? So if you say, oh, you know, that Popolo guy, that Popolo girl. So it wasn't like a nasty or a
negative. Okay, I didn't know that. I just know they was looking at me and calling. Okay, that's good to know.
On the other hand, it was more like, you know, just like how when they say the N word, they put it with a G at the end that makes it real rough. And mm-hmm. that would, you know, stir up all kinds of emotions.
Yeah.
So I grew up learning how to use this a lot, you know, and I mean, sad to say, that's pretty much how it was. I got teased. See, if they were to see me with my mom, a lot of kids would tell me, that's not your mom. That's your auntie. Or that's not, no, that's
and this
my
is
mom.
In Hawaii. This is in Hawaii.
In Hawaii. Right. Because I'm dark and my mom looks more, which Hawaiians are dark skinned. You know, you ask me, they're, if you ask me, but that's a whole nother show. Right. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So I got teased a lot. I fought a lot. And, you know, I got to tell you, Sean, it got to the point in my life where I wish I was an African American. You know, it hurts so much that I wish that I could look like my mother and light skinned or, you know, more Hawaiian or, you know, whatever it may be. You know, I just couldn't stand being in my skin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was hard. Now, the children that were teasing you or the people even, because I don't know about you, I came across adults that were shady, too. But the kids, and what were these, the, you know, ethnicity of these kids?
They were Polynesian. A lot of them were Samoan. A lot of them were Filipinos, you know. And again, you got to remember, like, today in Hawaii, there's a lot of African Americans than it was when I was growing up there. You know, yeah. There was just a few in mm-hmm. our project area, that few family, that, and we all knew each other, but we were minority. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? We were outdated, but that's because that's all they seen was my skin, the color of my skin versus, you know, what was happening in our house. So we were eating local food, was eating Hawaiian food. Yeah. You know, unfortunately, it's sad to say we never learned the Hawaiian language, but you know what I'm saying? So, yeah, it was really rough growing up being African-American and Hawaiian.
Mm-hmm. Do you have some, like, what are some of your good memories of like being on the island, being a Black woman? I mean, and when you came to realization that you were getting better and getting more accepting of being in your skin as a Black woman?
Good question. You know, the best memories, I got to say, is going over family house. And, you know, grown-ups will do whatever they do, you know me, hana kapila, play music, drink, or whatever. And as kids, as cousins, we all stick together and we just be, the good thing about it, if you was going to Auntie so-and-so's house, that means we could stay out late till the lights come off. And, you know, the best memories I have is hanging out with cousins. It's just all about family. It was always about family, you know, just having fun, no trouble. I mean, you never get in trouble with your cousins, but it was like a treat for us to be around our families and, you know, do fun things together and get to know each other. My best memory, beaches, always packing up home, whatever food, whether it was musubi, whatever, crack it up with six kids, get in that station wagon, and we were gone. You know, you know, my mom did what she had to do to raise us kids, and, you know, just to make sure that we wasn't just stuck in that environment.
Mindset, right. Now, I know y'all went to the drive-ins.
We went to the, you talking years.
Girl, I was there too. That was fun.
Those were awesome. I probably shouldn't be saying this, but I remember, like, my brothers had a trunk, so there'd be one less kid to have to pay for, so we could come in and we'll put the blanket down. And that was fun. And never spent a dime there on any popcorn, because we always brought our
own food.
We brought our own food. Yes, those were the days. Exactly.
Man, oh, it broke my heart when I saw they were starting to take down the drive-ins. But I think they're going to make a comeback. The drive-ins in Hawaii.
They should.
But, yeah, my foster mom, Auntie Paula, she, same thing. She kept a big old truck. That's why to this day, I mean, I just recently got a truck. And people out here, I'm in Washington State, they think I got the truck because out here it means rugged, you know, farm worker or what have you. I'm thinking, in my mind, I got some surfboards and some boogie boards in the back drive and a cooler with some food in it. That's what I'm thinking about when I have my truck. And it's a totally different mindset. They be trying to race me on the freeway and I'm cruising, listening to my music, girl. It is, all those were some good memories.
Yes,
good
it
memories.
Was.
What else?
What are the great memories? Every time, I can only think of family, like going over family's houses, doing things as a family. We used to do the skate world and skate landing by Pahu. Those are fun. Going over my cousins in South in Makakilo, you know what I mean? I think, and they were of same ethnicity as us. You know, they were African-American and they were Polynesian. You know what I mean? So that was kind of like cool to see other family members that were dark like me. Mm-hmm. And they seemed okay with it. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I was having a hard time, but they seemed okay with it. And, you know, it took a lot of, you know, going down the wrong road and making wrong choices that led me to get to know me more. You know, I had to really buckle down and get to know Gwen, you know, and I had to learn to love me unconditionally. I had to learn how to be comfortable in my own skin. And, you know, I always think the best leaders or the best teachers are those who experienced it, right? And that's exactly what I did. And here I am today, you know, empowering other women, helping others, you know, get their lives back, and not to mention helping people get out of financial debt. So, yeah.
Beautiful. That's beautiful. So now before I get to healing tips and strategies for getting you through those hard times, make sure I get all these points. Now we talked on some of the challenges. Now you just recently left Hawaii, am I right?
Yes, last year.
So, because I remember when I, you know, the situation with the housing and the beaches and, you know, people, you know, and rehab and stuff. Could you see yourself going to live back there? What are some of the challenges that you see that may have, you know, because I know some other local people that just, they live in the mainland, the States here, right? And they you know, they haven't been back in a while. Because I know they miss it. I know you miss it.
I do. I really do. But to be honest with you, Shauna, never. I can never see myself going back there to live. You know, it's really sad. I probably should have made this move a long time ago, but, you know, everything happens for a reason. The homelessness, the crying, the joy, and it's everywhere. I get it. You know, it's everywhere. But it's just really, really sad to see how our land, our islands just went into pieces, just drastically, yeah. You know, over a period of time, you know? So would I ever move back home? Absolutely not. Visit, of course, you know. I would never move back home, and it's extremely expensive. It's just sad. It's just sad that it's overpopulated on Oahu, at least, you know? I can't see myself moving back home, and I probably should have moved a long time ago, but like I said, everything happens for a reason. You know, I had still some work to do back there, and here I am.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And that's beautiful. And, you know, visits can turn into, you know, extended visits, connecting with your family, whichever way you want. I mean, you know, you always have a place to go back to. I mean, mm-hmm. always having a connection like that. I mean, I wasn't born and raised like you, you know, and Yvonne, and the other guests before you. But I just, you know, spent some time there, and I feel honored to have that connection from your home. Right. You know, I left the States, just in time. I found out later, just in time to miss the crack epidemic in Long Island, Hempstead, and it hit there really hard. So to be in a place like Hawaii, you know, it was mild then. It was mild, you know, that was when crack was first hitting the East Coast, even, you know what I'm saying? So I feel And someone said to me, oh, you were, you know, the spirits, the gods and goddesses of the of those islands kept you safe. And I was like, oh yeah, you know, that's right. And the people, the aloha, the welcoming in, like your family had done for me. And, you know, I'm so honored to have that experience. It's really helped me as a full woman. So I understand what you mean. Now you connect with other women, other local or Polynesian women, Black women, you know, and do work, or how do you do your connection?
I connect with everyone, all ethnicity. I mean, look what I went through. You know, for me to just stick with one and stick, you know, I mean, you hurting, I got you. You know what I'm saying? If I can help, I got you. And it's all about helping. It's all about the aloha. You know, you even mentioned Pele, I think in the last one, and you just was talking about the gods, you know, and whoever had told you, I'm not sure who you said, told you about the gods was probably protecting you. But we all know Pele is the god of fire, right? The volcano erupts, oh, Pele's upset, you know, and all that kind of stuff. So when you was going through your trials and tribulations, right? Right, Pele was putting her fire away for them, and they were protecting me. I believe that was your protection. Same like me. I truly believe that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Out of all the gods that I that there are in Hawaii that, you know, we don't talk much about growing up, because it's not like that's a, you know, we got Spanish class, Japan, you know, subjects in school, but we don't have Hawaiiana, right?
Wow.
There's none of that. So Pele is one of the more, when I was growing up, popular god that all of us know about. You know what I mean? So I'm really familiar with her too. So I believe that whoever told you that, I believe that's the truth. You know, Pele was protecting you. The gods were protecting you, protecting us, you know, and I'm truly blessed and grateful that I know a little bit enough, or you know, a little bit of my culture that I can, you know, instill into my daughter, my my grandchildren, so that they can learn. Because, I mean, I just think it's sad that we don't know much about our Hawaiian ethnicity, our Hawaiian language, our culture, you know, other than the food. No, I'm just joking.
I want to say to that, because being someone who wasn't from the island and from the States, I learned a lot. You know, my mother was intentional about that part, learning a lot about the island. So you can still grasp that. And I hear they doing classes and stuff. And I think it's real important, you that has that mixture of African-American and the other mixtures that you have, to learn that other language, because that I feel like that's a part of our healing as Black women in particular. I'm gonna talk about it's definitely a part of our healing to learn and connect to different cultures that may be what made us. So I hear you. It's sad too that I have to relearn my culture from, you know, being African American, and I'm still learning stuff about what the African Americans did in this country and how we built the country. So you know what I'm saying? I'm still learning that. So I can only imagine if I had the addition of a Polynesian side and the islands and King Kamehameha and, you know, Liliuokalani, you know what I'm saying? I was able to connect my mom because they were brown. They were presented to me as brown people. So, you know, as we do this series some more, and as I have you back on, we're gonna dig up some pictures of some Hawaiians. And I think they did a really good job in the movie Moana. What do you think about that?
Oh yeah. Moana is amazing. I mean from the features to the land, to Maui, if you never knew anything about Hawaii, after watching Moana, you've learned a lot. Learned a lot. So I thought it was an amazing movie. I mean, I love that. And my granddaughter, that's her favorite.
Yes. And from what I learned, you can correct me if I'm wrong, Hawaiian, Polynesian, they, you know, y'all were a matriarchal people. And so Moana, and I love the way, you know, they showed all different shades. You see the dark skinned women there?
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, they did. I was like, okay, somebody was intentional about that.
Right.
Oh man, it was just, so I know I had another question, but it lost, but this is it right here. I'm glad you was happy with Moana, because I thought, oh my goodness, that is a wonderful intro.
Yeah, there was no offense. You know, a lot of people say, oh, why they have to make her look like that? And why they have to, that's us. You know, let's keep that real all the way around. That's us. You know what I mean?
Yes.
We're bigger, we got the features, and you know,
that was the one. That was the part I was going to say. And also the culture was, the bigger the woman was, the more beautiful she was considered.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay. That's what I remember. I remember hearing that part.
So it's kind of like other nationalities, like if you're too thin, or, you know, then you need to eat,
Yeah.
You know how, you know what I'm talking about, right?
Especially that's in
how
African Hawaiians culture. Are. They play now, but yep.
Right. You rarely going to see very thin Hawaiian females. You know what I mean? They like, you know, that we love to eat and, you know, we get down like that. And, you know, I mean, not that, that's why obesity, you know, in the islands is huge with the Polynesians. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Because we just love to eat. Mm-hmm. That's just how we built. We're not built slim. We built big bone. Yeah.
And see, there's a difference between being big bone and a big people, because everything's, you know, based on this European standard. Now that we wasn't, you know, we wasn't, that's not our features. That's not us. That's not who we was. You know what I'm saying? Which is why we survive a lot and we age very nicely. So, you know what I'm saying? So, I mean, I'm not complaining. I'll take extra juice for beauty. But you know what I'm saying? We don't all have to be. And that was one thing, you know, when I was teaching and they were like telling the Samoan kids, oh, they, you know, they're obese, and then telling the little Asian kids who were extra small, you know, I had to come to bat for some parents because they was trying to tell them, you're not feeding them enough with child abuse. I mean, they go there with some of these systems, yes. I'm sure you right. know, right? So learning, having folks learn, as long as we healthy, I mean, we know when it's extra. If you can't move around on your own and you having a hard time doing stuff, okay. Right. But right. if you know what I'm saying, if you just big and chunky and you getting on and you living long, folks was living long, no diseases, you know. Anyway, so I think there's a way to go back to that. But it sounds like you're like, you still keep that connection. Do you have something with your daughter? And you like, you've been saying a couple of Hawaiian words. And I've been like wanting to keep a note. I should have been taking notes because I want to go back and be like, what was that? I think you was describing your grandchildren. What's the word for that?
Ho'opuna.
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 Okay. Yeah. With the O?
H. Ho'opuna.
Ho'opuna. Mm-hmm. Beautiful, beautiful. So you got some of the language. You even have a Hawaiian middle name. What's your middle name?
Ku'ule. Yeah, so Ku'ule. All my life I was taught Ku'ule means my precious heart, right? Years went on, and I, you know, as I'm naming my own child, only have one. I have one daughter. I was looking up Hawaiian names, and I came to realize that Ku'u means my, and Le means garden of flowers. So my garden of flowers. You know, so Ku'ule means my garden of flowers.
What's your favorite Hawaiian flower?
Lily.
Oh man, we gotta write that down and find a picture of that.
Lily, yeah. Mine's and my mother's, you know, Lily.
Lilies? Mm-hmm. Are lilies like original to Hawaii?
That's a good question. I'm not sure if it's original to Hawaii, if it's that's always been my flower. Hibiscus is pretty, all these other flowers, but lilies do not. Lilies just brings like they're so beautiful. I feel they're so beautiful, you know, whether yellow lilies, white lilies, you know what I mean? I think they're beautiful.
Man, you know, mine was, of course, plumeria. But you know, there's so many. There's so many now that I think people brought some over and they flourish in that environment.
Gardenias are, and also another beautiful, and it smells real, you know, strong and you know, sweet. That's another popular flower, gardenias. But yeah, I love lilies.
And the ones they do the lays with and stuff. So, I mean, so are you getting a chance? Hold on. Let me get my gathering stick because I want to go with the whole, are you like connected and getting like products from Hawaii? I know if you just recently left, that means that you got some cooking that you like to do. Have you found a way in Texas to, how you doing your menu now?
Okay, so I gotta admit, I am not a great, great cook, right? But now that I moved off and, you know, got married and things, I have to cook. So aloha shoyu, or soy sauce, I guess you can say out here, soy sauce, but we call it shoyu at home. Yeah, I just found an Asian market up the street from where I live here in Texas that sells aloha soy sauce. That's a must for me. I don't do the kikkoman, I don't do the I need aloha soy sauce. So I got that. Luau leaves, I have not found any here. I hear the Asian markets have it. I hear other national, like India, whatever. I haven't found that. You know, there's this, I'm pretty, you know, when I talk about lau laus with the luau leaves and you put the pork, the fish and the butter fish inside. Yeah. So
show and you. And the spinach, right? They put spinach inside some of them.
It's not spinach. It looks like spinach. It's green like spinach. It looks like mustard greens and collard greens, but it's luau leaves.
Luau leaves. So that's what I was tasting. Girl, that's so delicious. Okay. I thought it was spinach. Oh, it's so good.
Yep.
Oh, it's so good.
Oh, that's pretty much, that was my main thing that I separated from Hawaii is the soy sauce. And of course, we eat a lot of rice at home, right? But that's not a problem. I can switch up with rice here. Poi. Mm-hmm. You know, out here it's hard. At home, we get them fresh, right? You get the fresh bag of poi. You know, any place else, you'd have to pound the taro to make it soft and like a pasty kind of, you know, thing. You familiar with poi?
Yes, I'm very familiar.
You're like, girl, you're a poi, yeah.
Yes, the sweet. I know you can do this. You can do it a little sweet for babies. It's pretty good for babies when it's like, you know, I always wanted to try that. But the sweet and the just the regular. With the pokey, oh yes.
Yes, right. And that's another thing. Ahi, right? Ahi mm-hmm. simply means tuna. So we can get that here and make poke. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So yeah. The food part I don't have a problem with. It was just that main ingredient of soy sauce. I know it sounds weird, but if you somebody from Hawaii, you always put soy on your rice, soy on your rice, that. So yeah.
And that's that cultural mixture that was so amazing. I mean, you know, that was the Japanese, not the Chinese yet. That was the Japanese coming over, and then the other Asian culture. What I remember is like it was two main ones: Japanese and Filipinos.
Filipinos, correct.
Okay. And Puerto Ricans. I found out later. I was wondering when I was on Maui, what was Puerto Ricans doing on Maui? And they was there. They had come over to work in the sugarcane fields and the pineapple fields because the islands are so similar. But I'm real talk. I've been to Puerto Rico, and let me tell you something: Hawaii beats them. Hawaii hands down. Don't tell nobody I said that.
You just did.
Hawaii beaches. I'm sorry, y'all. I'm sorry. And that was my first introduction to a beach ever. So you know my standards are way up here. People try to tell me, oh, let's go to the beach. We go to other places. Virginia, even here in Washington, I'm like.
Diana Beach.
Right.
If that water ain't clear enough and nice and blue, then I'll pass, right?
Thank you. No rocks. So now, okay. So you know you're pretty much not going to go back. But now I'm having all these visions of like a girl, a women's, you know, situationship that gathers and goes to the island to do this, you know, reconnecting with the goddesses and what have you. It's a part of our cultural, you know, cultural dynamics and cultural possibilities. But what would something like that look like for you, especially in the work that you do? What would some work like that be if that question made sense?
Try again. Let me try.
right. You take your daughter, you and your daughter, and you go back and you kind of explore the island from a different perspective. Maybe you go to another side of the island you've never been to before, or another island. I mean, I've been to one other island, that was Maui, and it was gorgeous. But I want to go to the others, you know. I want to hit up what's the big island, Lanai, where the volcano's active. I want to do some like active honoring of Pele, you know what I'm saying? So what would that look like for you?
Okay, so I got you now. I gotta tell you, I've been to, well, we got family on Kauai. We got family in Hawaii, the big island where the volcanoes erupt. And we got family on Maui. Now, Molokai, I'm not sure. And Lanai is a whole different. We know Kahoʻolawe is not even happening, right? Now, what would that look like? That'll be a beautiful thing, I think. My daughter is born and raised in Hawaii, right? I just left last year. So it's my grandkid that's kind of been in North Carolina where she's at throughout their life, right? I would love to do something like that to keep them connected with the culture at home. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I want my grandkids to know that just because you guys was out here in North Carolina, wherever they are in the mainland, out here in the States, this will always be home. You know what I mean? So taking trips maybe every other year, every 2 years or something, just to different islands so they can get, you know, the feel of what their culture is, I would love to do. Even with women that never been to Hawaii, I would love to take them on trips and go as a whole, as a ohana, as a family. Just go. Yeah, that's something. But to live, different story. You know what I'm saying? To live, it'll be different. But I would love to do that on a regular basis.
Yeah. Well, we definitely got to have some more conversation about that. I would say for me and the women of color and leadership movement, our focus is to support women of color in their journeys and their healing journey. So, you know, doing those things, I think, especially for women of color, and I would say Black women in particular, because we oftentimes feel like we're not African-Americans. I'm going to speak for African-Americans versus, or instead of like Caribbean or Black women from the continent, because those women are coming from places where they know they got a connection. African-American women in particular oftentimes feel displaced until we learn our history and learn, oh, wait a minute, we belong here too, right? So, but that takes work like this. That takes like someone like you who knows, you know, the different islands, the names of the islands, the pronunciation, to see a Black woman, a dark-skinned Black woman like yourself, you know, be like speaking the way you're speaking, which is beautiful. Your accent is gorgeous. And, you know, being able to run down the languages like the Mo'ana and the da-da-da. I remember the stuff I did, you know what I'm saying? It just comes out, right? I remember stuff just listening and being back around y'all, because when I was in school, they made us have to learn Hawaiian history. So I'm reading, the language wasn't there, but definitely the history. And also, like I said, I had a good education from my mother before we got there. So I already respected the culture and wanted to learn more. But I'm saying, you know, this kind of work, I'm just going to say, I really feel like it's really important for Black women, Polynesian women, other women in that genre to go back and heal first. And then, you know, reach out, you know, connect with others. Because once you start traveling the islands, you just need to know folks that are privileged, majority white, they got property on all those other islands. So a woman like you not being able to go to the other islands, you know, is a challenge. But for them, it's not. They've been exploring your island. So it's our turn.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So, and I'd love to, you know, talk with you more about making that happen for us. So what, but you were mentioning the islands, and there was one island in there that you said, oh, we already know about that, but I don't know. What's the, tell us the tea.
Oh, Kahoolawe. The Kahoolawe, yeah. We know the military, that's that island, you know, way on the side. Oh, when you look at the eight islands, the chain of islands that military use for bombing, and if the only military would go there, and I'm not even sure if anybody can do that today. You know, but back in the day, that's where the military would practice. But that's how they go out in the field at home and school field and all that kind of stuff. They go out in the range and field. They'll use that island to practice all their bombing. So nobody goes there. Lanai, you would have to, it's a very small island. Kahoolawe is the smallest. Lanai is the next smallest. I'm sorry, Niihau is the next smallest. But Lanai is another small island that everybody knows everybody. And if anybody that's going to speak Hawaiian, it's going to be on that island. It's going to be on that island, you know. So very small island that, you know, everybody's family pretty much. And if you're not family, because it's such a small island, you become family. So
it's all right. Yeah. See. Yeah. And to have that expectancy, to even have that in your cultural language is what just nurtured me. Because I didn't have that. I was disconnected from my family. So the fact that you just said that, you wasn't like, I was kind of expecting you to say, oh, if they don't know you, you ain't out, you're out. But you said, but you said something totally different. Like, oh, you ain't family, you gonna be family. I'm like, oh, see, yeah. I remember that.
Yeah, and see, that's what I loved about, and, you know, and I get some of that here too. You know, that's what I love about Hawaii. If you not blood, we seen you one, two times. You on the side, come my house. Oh, let's go. You know, yes. That's just how it was. If you outside and you knock on my door to come outside and we eating dinner, my mom said, tell her come inside too, sit down, eat.
Eat, yes, yes.
That's how it was, you know. Where the problem, the challenges came for me is going to school, at school, coming home from school, being teased and, you know, having my butt slapped and black in and this and that and, you know, pushed and, you know, all that. That's where the problem came for where I had, you know, this became a good friend of mine after a while, you know what I'm saying? And sad, I mean, but later on as I got older, like in my intermediate years, the same individual that I used to have to fight with, I became really good, close friends with,
you know? That doesn't surprise me. What do you think that's about?
They seen that I'm not giving up, that like they could keep bullying me, they couldn't keep pushing me around, that I was going, you know, it's like this. if I can't beat them, then I might as well join them. You know what I mean? And they wasn't beating me because I wasn't going home getting, you know, I was not going home and getting, you know, I was brought up, if you come home with lickings or with, if you come home with a whooping.
Lickings. I remember that lickings. You got lickings.
Right. So if you're getting, so I was making sure that if I was coming home, my knuckles were, it was because my knuckles were this because I hit her tooth or his tooth or something. It wasn't knuckle because I got my butt whooped. You know what I mean?
Really? Yeah, yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah.
So what would happen if you, what would happen if you did get lickings?
What do you mean what would happen? Like if I was outside?
Yeah, if you had to
get lickings.
Oh, okay. So you would be like, you better fight them kids back. Wow.
So my whole thing, my mom was like this, and I'm the baby of six, so I can't speak for my older sibling, but I know how it was for me. You know, you don't go around pushing nobody. You don't go out and start a fight. A spike come your way, they hit first, get it. Okay, you come home and get lickings, meaning you come home black eye, bust it up, I'm gonna whoop your butt. So I have to, when I'm out there, you know, doing me, I have to think, now, did I want to come home and be already bust up by out there and then get lickings? Or go out there and come home and I would scratch right here and be like, well, I did it, mom, you know, I handle mine. You know what I mean? And that just made us stronger because it's not like she sat us around and said, here, this is how you fight. No, my mom never did that. You know what I mean? It's just like, you don't go out there, start no trouble, but trouble comes your way. They hit you first. You know, they hit you first. Go at it.
Now, see, but you was the youngest. I don't know if that would have worked for me, girl. That's more conversation that we're gonna have, you know, as far as like black women in particular, just really having a fight. I remember that within even the Polynesian families, the girls was expected to, and I was like, wow. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And that wasn't where I was coming from, because I wasn't from that part of the East Coast. So I was like, whoa, but people still felt a little bit, my presence still protected me a lot.
Yeah,
it protected me because I had been around some ghetto kids in New York and Harlem and in Long Island, you know what I'm saying? So coming out there in Hawaii, it was kind of lightweight, but still, it was still, you know, I still felt, you know, and they must have felt my presence because I had, you know,
right.
And I'm not a fighter unless somebody hit me or hit somebody I care about. Woo! And so, you know, right. but you saying it benefited you, it made you stronger, than that, but you were the youngest of eight. So then you didn't have like the family reputation on your side.
So I'm the youngest. Oh gosh, I'm the youngest of six. My oldest sibling is 12 years older than me. The one right above me, he had those problems too. Now he's 5 years older than me, my brother. So I watch him fight and I watch him grab a 2x4 and, you know, go at it, you know. And back then when we were fighting, you know, this morning, you don't just fight one. It's never up.
It's still the same. They still do
that. You have
same.
To fight all of them. You know, they all come. The family might come. And,
the whole family. Know,
you know, you got to fight them all. You know, and you know, we knew that. We knew we wasn't just dealing with one. We knew that the next day, somebody, two or three of them will come and do something. We knew that. But what we were going to do? You know, we were a minority. I mean, there's nothing we could do. We just had to get out there and do. I mean, I don't know. I think that's, it just made me a stronger individual, a stronger woman. And it made them realize that this wasn't going to happen forever unless y'all want to keep on fighting. You know what I'm saying? Like, this was going to, it was useless after a while. So, I mean, y'all see that I'm pretty much handling my own by myself without other people jumping in for me. I mean, and we became very close at the end. Honestly, we did.
Wow.
Yeah, a few of us did, that I used to fight with, like, on a regular.
Yeah.
Dudes, now males, I'm talking about kids, Yep.
That's very interesting. Well, I mean, like I said, you know, I saw some stuff that really kind of, you know, especially with Samoans, that really kind of affected me, you know, as far as, like, fighting girls, fighting sisters and stuff in their family, and I don't know, yeah, I know. And I was just like, wow, okay, that's not. But it was a really interesting cultural dynamic. I mean, I the first time I saw violence in high school, domestic violence actually, with teenagers was when I was in high school. And you know, this dude wasn't Samoan, and I think he was like, you know, just Polynesian, not really, you know, distinguishable, but and he had a little Asian girlfriend. She was islanded, and he was like pouncing on her in the school. The security guards had to tell, and that shocked me. That shocked me because, you know, so would you say that was a part of some of parts of the culture or the dynamics? So what would you say?
Yeah.
I know, right?
I have to say that. Yeah. Yeah. I'm gonna leave it right there. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's sad. That's why, but I know exactly what you're talking about. You know, that is part of the culture. Yeah.
Some of the dynamics. It'd be interesting to find out if that, you know, that was like historically before other folks moved in and started influencing and those kind of dynamics. I think that, you know, definitely more conversation, more intent conversation, because I've like also had conversations with women from like the indigenous Native American, you know, groups, and they share some stories as well. And as African American, I speak for African Americans, there's a Black woman killed every 5 hours by someone who looks like her, not the cops. You know what I'm saying? And so those are things that we really have to start having conversation about. So being someone who also grew up in that culture, I was always curious about those dynamics when I would see them, because they would really scare me. And, you know, realizing that we have these within some of our cultures, us as African Americans, huge, huge challenges between Black women and Black men right now. Indigenous, other groups, but see, they keep theirs quiet. Everybody hears about Black folks, we on blast on all over social media, but they keep those quiet. Like, you know, my Latino sisters, when I, you know, talk with Mexicans, Puerto Ricans, Cuban, you know what I'm saying? They got their stories, you know what I'm saying? Machismo, you know? So it's like, okay, we need to have these conversations. My Indian women from India, they, you know, they be all up in the news and stuff. So there's bigger conversations to have around, you know, women in particular of color. I'm just gonna say that. And the different dynamics that we come in contact with trying to hold on to our traditions, the beautifulness of our cultures, and then also dealing with the challenges that we very much so are, you know, are dealing with, you know, because I saw some serious challenges that I can remember to compare to some African-American men with Polynesian men, local men, you know, it seemed to be, you know, same kind of challenges and struggles in those dynamics. That's what I saw, but you've been out there longer. What would you say to that part?
I totally agree. You know, and I don't know why when it comes to that, I kind of just shy away from the subjects and kind of maybe I don't want to, you know, have it replay in my head or whatever. I totally agree.
And I'm perfectly happy with saying I was an observer coming in as a child too, and just saw some stuff. And again, you know, I'm not, you know, I don't see it as so much putting it on blast as much as we definitely need to talk about this, but that's one of the subjects that the Women of Color Leadership movement and myself, and, you know, in particular, just really has been following the Black femicide. And, you know, and of course, listening to my sisters, my Native sisters that have been talking about missing and murdered Indigenous women, their plight, and, you know, just other folks, you know, how we getting these stories together. And I think it's going to be women that's going to heal the culture, you know, but it's got to be us, you know, in our divine femininity. And so having that experience on your island with Pele and just running into beautiful women like yourself and Yvonne and more has just really added, because I didn't, like I said, I didn't have my family. You know, my mother was out there. It was just me and my mom that moved, and my grandma died when I was on Maui. So y'all filled in really beautifully, right. You know, and that was the, you know, I really see the benefits now, because I come into contact with African Americans who have never been off their block. I realize their perspective is very, very different than mine. And mine is different because, well, number one, because my mother was she was bicultural, inquisitive. She was a researcher. But she took me to that island and opened up my mind, and I was open and wanting to learn about somebody else. And I felt like there was a connection. So if I hadn't had that experience, it wouldn't have helped me now. Cause I see folks, like I said, who ain't been off their block, and they struggle when they come across, different people.
Right.
You know, I mean, and there's a question in there. The question in there for you before we, you know, get ready to wind down a little bit is, you know, do you feel you coming to the mainland now, you know, and your years, as I heard you say a couple of times, you felt like you should have left earlier. Now that you're in your new space, how are you feeling that cultural connection? If you're understanding, you know, if I'm making the question kind of clear.
Let's see. I don't built Gwen up from nothing. You know what I mean? I don't built Gwen up that I learned to adapt everywhere today. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So this is totally different than home. This whole lifestyle here in Texas, totally different. You know, I mean, I don't have a lot of friends, you know, like I would have at home, of course. And that's because when I interact or communicate with male, females of all ethnicity around here, I hello, respond, you know, how you doing, whatever, I keep it moving. You know what I'm saying? But I find that I can always have a piece of home with me wherever I go. You know what I mean? I'm gonna always have a piece of that with me. I mean, it's just instilled in me. It's the way I communicate. It's how I just love helping people. That aloha inside of me, whether you're African-American women and, you know what I mean? How I think others accept me might be a little bit different.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Like, I talk different. You know, I have a neighbor recently that just moved in. She was like, are you Jamaican? And I was like, no. And I said, I'm African-American. She was like, you what? And I was like, I'm African-American Hawaiian. And she was like, Hawaiian. And she's like, you must be. And I'm like, do I have to say this another time? You know what I mean? Like, so I have that kind of, because they just don't get it. Like, if I Hawaiian, nothing. Again, it's back to this. Hawaiian, no. Jamaican, you sound like you're Jamaican because you're talking broken English. We call it at home, but you talk different. So, I mean, I hope that answers your question. Like, you know, I can adapt here, and how people view me and as I speak, and it's mostly when I speak, only when I speak, grocery stores or whatever, I'm like, thanks, Sam. Or they look at me like, what? You know what I mean? Thanks, but other than that, I mean, I hope I'm answering your question.
You are. I love it. You know, how do you feel about the title Afro Hawaiian?
It's a title that it's a title that I usually don't, I'm going to be really honest. This is how I'm Black Hawaiian. I'm still with the Black, you know, we're African-American. We went from
that's
a Black.
Beautiful right there.
I'm Black Hawaiian. I'm Black Hawaiian, you know?
Yeah.
But when I say Hawaiian again, it's like, huh? Hawaiian. Like from Hawaii, yes, ma'am. I still get that. And you know, it is what it is. I keep it pushing.
And you know what that is, right? That's folks that ain't never been off their block. Or they see, you know, and what they represent when they represent Hawaii in the media. It's a little skinny Asian looking woman. And that's not what, go look up what traditional, well, look at the movie Moana, but go look up what traditional Hawaiians look like, you know, and then you get more of a, oh, I can see what, and oh, wow, some of those characters are actually Black. That's right. Yeah. You know, check out the different islands, Fiji, the Marians, you know what I'm saying? Look it up, you know what I'm saying? So that's a call to other people to do their research, but you can tell people ain't been off the block. So I can like tell, I can say, okay, I can hear she's Afro-Cuban. I know that difference. You know, and you know, Afro-Boricua, Afro-Puerto Rican, just a darker skin Puerto Rican. That's all. Some of us know Puerto Ricans look like us too, but you know what I'm saying? Then you hear your accent and they're trying to place it. They're trying to place it. And that's teaching them something new. Black Hawaiian. Or Afro-Hawaiian, African-American Hawaiian, you know what I'm saying? And you say it again for the people in the back, because that's new for them. Whoever that person was, they went up, they thinking, blew their mind.
Yeah.
But I know it sounds like what you're saying is you're moving past the shame of that into the pride.
I'm been past the shame. It's okay. So I'm at home, my home, my island, and I had to already prove to you guys. And now, AKA, everything's okay. I went to down up, went back up, okaying her skin to come to another state to where I still getting questioned. Mm-hmm. And the difference today with back then is that when I get questioned or when I get told you're not Hawaiian, it was automatically dukes up. Today it's read my skin, read my skin, read my skin. You know what I mean? I can tell you over and over and over, and I don't have to prove no more because I can walk right on past you, but I'm not rude like that no more.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? I'm not that Gwen no more to where I feel I have to try to prove to you guys or to anybody, you know, and that's because of building Gwen up to who she is today. You know, it took a lot of work. It took a lot of work to be comfortable in this skin, but I am comfortable today.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
Yeah. So as we close out, like, would you any last like thoughts for anybody? If it could be, they might be in a similar journey, a similar path than what you're, you know, talking about.
I'm my thoughts to anybody out there that if anything we said today or tonight has, you know, impacted you anyway, never, ever, ever be afraid to speak up. Never be afraid to ask for help. You know, you may never know how or whose life, you know, besides your own, that you're helping by speaking up, by asking for help. You know, you don't have to go through it. You just don't have to suffer and go through it by yourself. There's a lot of us out there that can relate. And, you know, and we, well, I didn't speak for myself. Well, for us, we're more than welcome to help. You know what I mean? So always, always, always reach out and ask for help. Mm-hmm. Never let fear hold you down. Right?
That's what I said. Thank you. Well, thank you, Gwendolyn. I'm happy you say your full name because I love to hear that middle initial, your pronunciation of it. So tell us your full name again.
All right. So it's Gwendolyn Kuule Bailey.
Bailey. Thank you so much for giving us your time, sharing with us. And we're going to have you back on for this continuous series. We have more conversation. So thanks so much. And everybody.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Right on. And everybody, thanks for joining us, the Women of Color and Leadership Movement Community Podcast, in partnership with Media Island International. We'll be uploading this pretty soon on our website and on our YouTube channel. So stay tuned for that and be good to yourself. Peace.
All these islands and saw everything. How would they feel about the change of our lives? Could you just imagine if they were around and saw highways on the sacred grounds? How would they feel about this modern city? Other's eyes, yes.